Hello, everyone, and welcome to another PC Part Picker live stream. I'm Ryan.
And I'm Barry.
And today we're putting together a gaming machine inside of Fractal's brand new case.
Yeah, Fractal Design was kind enough to send us their brand new Focus G case. They also have the same case in black. They also have it in a mini version, the Focus G Mini. Mm-hmm. So thanks to Fractal for sending that, and also thank you to MSI for sending us the B350 motherboard, which we'll be putting inside it.
Yeah, check the description below for a link to the full part list. Let's get started, Barry.
Right. MSI sent us the Tomahawk B350. We're going to be putting in an AM4 R5 1600. There we go.
Right. And this motherboard has the Tomahawk, and they also have the Tomahawk Arctic as well, if you want kind of a white-silver instead of a black-red motherboard.
All right. Pull this out. Go ahead and pull out a couple more things here. We've got our I.O. shield, and then we have our SATA connectors because we are putting a traditional hard drive as well as an M.2.
Mm-hmm.
And then also, just for reference.
Oh, that's nice.
We have our RAM, just so we know which slots to put the RAMs in.
That's very cool. I don't know if you want to show that off real quick. It's the first time I've ever seen this. It's an insert specifically on how to install your memory.
Yeah, it's kind of a quick way. Instead of flipping through the manual to try to find the page and everything like that, they just say, hey, these are the DIMM slots you use. Mm-hmm. For depending on how many DIMMs of RAM that you're using.
Yeah, very simple. I like that. Instead of having to search through a motherboard manual.
Exactly.
And since we're at the beginning of the build here, what is that attached to your forearm, almost your elbow now?
It's anti-static wristband, Ryan, to help keep me grounded.
Okay.
Just to prevent any ESD from discharging on any of the components.
Yeah.
I like to stay safe. Mm-hmm. We're using the R5 1600.
Mm-hmm.
We are going to be using the stock cooler along with it. We will be doing one thing that's a little bit different with the stock cooler that we'll go over in just a little bit. So I'm going to set that off to the side.
Right.
Gonna open up our latch here.
Okay.
Blister pack.
They're pretty tight.
Yeah. It's not. Don't want to send the CPU flying across the room.
Yeah. I get a little scared with AM4 because it's got the pins on the CPU.
Yeah, the pins are on the bottom of the CPU, and I can tell which are on the motherboard, so it's a little hairy.
Yeah, but as long as you line up that the pin 1 indicators.
Yeah. Yeah, so you have a pin 1 indicator here, and then a pin 1 indicator there.
Right.
There you go. Just close the latch, secures it in, then latches into place.
Perfect.
We're using 16 gigs DDR4 Team Dark silver, kind of match with the aesthetic that we're going for.
Yeah, you know, this specific set of memory seems to be popping up a lot for us.
Yes.
it's well priced, it's got a good look, and it should work with our setup without issue.
Yeah. So we'll go ahead and open up slots 2 and 4.
Mm-hmm.
And then match the slot on the RAM with the post and the DIMM slot. Just mm-hmm. push down, and then everything will click.
Right, and this one has latches on both sides of the DIMM slot, correct?
Yes, correct. Latches on both sides.
Okay.
There we go. We're going to be using, for our primary SSD, 520 gigabyte Crucial M.2. Just standard SATA drives, not NVMe.
Okay.
Going to remove the screw for the M.2 right here.
Mm-hmm.
And the post for the M.2 was already in the correct location.
Okay. So 80 millimeter.
Yeah, 80 millimeter. So we'll just slide that in, push it in, and just kind of hold it down, and then just screw it back in.
Yeah. And even though it's not NVMe, it does save us two cables, a power and a data cable.
Correct.
So
yeah.
I personally, if the prices are close, I always like to go with the NVMe drive, or not the NVMe, the M.2 drives, simply right. Because they cut down on cable management.
Yeah, we are using the stock cooler, but one thing that we, the AMD stock coolers, is the way that they come, when we mount it, it's gonna mount like this. AMD is going to be sideways, which mm-hmm. most of the time we left it sideways because we've had an I.O. plate that goes over and there's writing sideways.
Right, to match the rest of the text on the motherboard.
Right. With this one, though, we don't really have anything going in that direction, so we're going to show you how to basically just pop this off real simple, spin it around, and then everything looks nice. And
okay. You know. And I think it'll actually put our cable closer to the CPU header.
Yes, it will. It'll put the cable closer to the CPU header.
And do be careful when handling this because the thermal paste is pre-applied, yes. Which you can see on the top there, that silver section in the middle.
Right. So holding this holding this fan on are four screws and then two additional screws right back here. And these are what holds the shroud on. So before you can really move anything,
right.
You need to remove these two screws. And so we've got the two screws removed there. So again, be careful just because of the thermal paste. Mm-hmm. You don't want to mess it up. And you just kind of pull it.
It just pops right off.
Yep, pops right off. So we'll stick it to the side. And now it's normally like this. So now just very carefully kind of hold the, you know, so I'm kind of trying to pull the fan cable away from it, mm-hmm. just to keep it from pushing on the thermal paste. And we'll just remove. Actually, we need a different header screwdriver head for that.
Different bit. Okay. The Dork Knight, great name, commenting that the thermal paste has a little bit of a tint on it on the bottom. And I definitely do see that as well.
I noticed that.
We'll check the temps, and if something is out of whack, we'll definitely go back with some new paste and run the benches again just to double check and make sure.
Yeah.
It's basically just removing a fan.
Yeah. And now we're just going to
turn it 90 degrees.
Yeah, turn it 90 degrees and reapply our screws. And actually, what I'm going to do here, just to save me from accidentally hitting that thermal paste, I'm just going to put it back in the holder that it came, just so I can get the screws started mm-hmm. and I don't accidentally slip off and hit that thermal paste.
Yeah.
Okay. And now you just basically reverse the order.
Mm-hmm.
You do want to be careful because these are self-tapping screws, so you don't want to start going in at a real extreme angle because then they will start
right
going in the wrong way.
Right.
Actually spin it around, that'll make it easier.
Yeah. But all in all, it's a pretty simple process to kind of just improve the aesthetic.
I'm just gonna make sure I just tighten everything up nicely. Should leave that in.
Yep.
Pull it back off. Thermal paste is still safe. And then we will just pop the cover back on.
And does this only go on one direction?
It only goes
the top section?
Yeah. Because the screws have
basically Yeah.
So if you did it the wrong way, then it would be upside down and then you'd have a whole nother process to go through. And then there's actually, if you look on the inside here, there's four tabs
mm-hmm.
In the corners. Match with four tabs or kind
of
indentions on the fans.
So perfect. Just
match those up and then pop it in. Yep.
So all right. Again. Awesome.
Switch the bits back and put our fan back together.
And part of the reason you have to do this is because it's not a square mounting.
Yes, it's not a square
mounting. It's a rectangle mount. So.
There we go. All right. So now our cooler is fixed. That'll go in an aesthetically pleasing way.
Mm-hmm.
The AMD logo facing up. So bring the motherboard back over here.
Right. But we have one more step before we can put it on, correct?
Yep, you still have one more step. So AMD motherboards come, there we go, come with this bracket right here, which is not what the stock cooler uses, so all you have to do is remove these brackets and still use the same backplate, but not the same the same mounting hardware that comes on the top.
Right, it's honestly interesting to me to see these brackets still on AM4. It seems like the vast majority of coolers with AM4 compatibility don't use them. I think one of the stock coolers might, but the rest of them that I've seen that you all have, you have to remove these brackets for all of them. So, interesting choice from AMD for sure, but 2 seconds to remove.
Right. And the nice thing is if you do it with the motherboard sitting down, you don't have to worry about putting the backplate on, trying to hold the backplate on.
Right.
and everything like that while you try to put on the cooler.
Right.
So now we will just take our cooler, fan up here,
right?
We'll just line it up with the back plate.
Yep, the mounting holes. And
yep. And then again, just screw it in. I don't like to screw it all the way down. Like the screw kind of in a star pattern.
Yeah, I was just about to say that. You barely started to get that one in, and it was already pulling very far away from that other side. So definitely start them all to a star pattern and then tighten them down.
Yeah. Oh, and this one right here actually didn't take over here.
Looks like that corner popped out too, far from you.
Far from me?
Yeah. So this one. Give that a little less, yeah.
There we go.
Mm-hmm. Well, all the screws have some springs on them too.
Yeah.
There you go.
Make sure this one takes.
IOCHU 1 gaming. So there's no heat spreaders on the M2 SSD. It's just a standard SATA one. It shouldn't get all that hot. I'd have to check this sheet to see where the thermal throttling happens, but. The case has a couple fans in the front, so they should be pushing the heat off there. We'll check temps, but I can't imagine it'll be an issue with this build.
Right. And from what we've seen just in our testing, once you start pushing air across that M.2, it
greatly reduces the temperatures just from like one fan.
Yeah.
So.
All right. So our cooler's on. We're gonna go ahead and plug in our fan. So.
Yeah. It's a CPU header. CPU fan header.
All right. Perfect. And we are basically to the point where I'm going to put the motherboard off to the side.
All right.
And put it over here in front of you.
Sounds good.
And then I'm going to go ahead and, before we bring the case back out, I'm going to go ahead and prep the power supply.
All right.
That way we can get it in there. We're using a Seasonic 550-watt semi-modular power supply.
80 plus gold.
Yeah, 80 plus gold.
G series. So it's a quality power supply.
Back cables, power supply itself. All right, so we are using a traditional hard drive. So we got a SATA plug. Our 24 pin and our 8 pin EPS are already on there. So we'll just kind of stick those off to the side for right now. And then we'll start doing our
plugging in the other side.
Yeah, plugging in the other side.
That's a short cable too.
Yeah. Yeah, so, and because of that, it is a shorter cable than normal, and then just for cable management, you can kind of look at it and think that this is going to be the way that it sits in the case. So, SATA is not something I really want to see, so I'm putting it closer to the back.
Okay.
Just to kind of help with cable management and make sure we don't run into any issues with running to the hard drive, but I think we'll be fine.
Okay.
There you go. PCIe. One right there. We got one more right here. All right. So now I'm going to stick this back off over here so we can bring it
now in. You want the case back?
Yeah. So just standard ATX has a nice large window. It's not tempered glass. Some people may like that. Some people not like this. I think it's a nice looking window. Both sides are kind of pooched out. So the back, this has got a little pooch on the back, which gives you a little bit more room for cable management, which I appreciate. Take these side panels off.
Yeah.
The other nice thing, it's got captive screws, so they
didn't. Oh, very nice.
They didn't fall away.
That's surprising, man. That's something I've seen kind of disappear. It seems like on a lot of cases, regardless of price point. So to see it on a $50 MSRP kind of more budget-oriented case, that's nice.
Right. So now we have the inside. We have two 5 1/4 inch bays for anybody still using those. I know some people still like to have their Blu-rays and everything like that. I don't want to slow down the network with streaming it. two 3 1/2 inch hard drive trays here, and then there's also an additional SSD mount
on the back.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right here at the back, down at the bottom. So you'd mount it basically so you'd have your SATA power and SATA data right here coming right in from the motherboard. So it was thought out.
There's a question from Geppetto. What is, like, how heavy were the side panels? How do they feel compared to ideally other fractal cases?
Like
R4, R5.
Right. I have the Define S on my desk, and they feel a little bit lighter than the Define S. However, the Define S has that sound dampening that's on the inside.
True.
So I imagine if you took out the sound dampening, it still feels good. You can feel the paint. I don't know if you got a chance to play with it too much.
Oh, it feels nice. It's like actually textured and not just a glossy.
Right. It's nice and textured. I think it has a nice feel to it. They feel they're sturdy.
Mm-hmm.
So there, I would give them a thumbs up on that.
Yeah, and we had also a comment from AdamJW78 talking about the point of SSD mounts on the back, like asking, you know, why are those there? I mean, for me, the biggest reason is cable management.
Yeah.
And it just hides it. Like, mounting a 2.5-inch SSD into, like, a 3.5-inch cage.
Right.
Kind of looks a little clunky. And
right. It gets that out of the way. It gives you a cleaner aesthetic. If, you know, some people, aesthetic is their thing. Some people, aesthetic is not their thing. They just want most power. Just, you know, cram stuff in. This gives you an option where it's a $50 price point. You can still hide the SSD if you don't have an M.2, and it still look good.
Right.
So this is your standard. We'll have to install our standoffs, which we'll go over in the box in a second. Mm-hmm. Top filters are screwed in, which is different. Normally, you'd have filters that are a little bit more easily removable.
Right.
But I do like that they actually have top filters and not instead of not having any filters at top. Mm-hmm. And then front filter, which the front pops off.
Somehow.
Yeah.
Yeah, the only thing I'll say about screw-in filters on the top is that they do add thickness.
Yeah.
So if you're planning to try to sneak a radiator in there, I'm not sure if you could, to be honest, that it's pretty tight in terms of thickness.
So the front is filtered. Again, it's not a traditional filter, but you can still take this off, blow it out.
Right.
So, and it does come with to 120 millimeter fans. It's Fractal's Silent Series LL, and they do light up. They have white LEDs.
Yeah.
So,
but to be honest, it comes apart pretty nicely. Like, this is, if you're looking for a less expensive modding platform, like case to mod, this is a pretty decent starting point too.
Real good.
So
I'm just gonna leave the case deconstructed actually.
And I haven't seen the question yet, but the fans, at least on this edition, are white LED.
Yes.
So, not blue. There's some questions about that earlier.
Right. So we'll go over the box that comes with it, and you know, basically standard stuff. We have standoffs, power supply screws, motherboard screws. It does have a standoff tool. Mm-hmm. Greatly appreciate it. Saves my thumbs.
Always nice to have that.
And then you have extra thumb screws, and then other screws for if you want to mount, you know, optical drives, additional hard drives, stuff like that. And then the other always added bonus of zip ties.
And so, is that 5 1/4? Is that removable? I'm seeing what I think are screws. I can't tell if they're punches.
No, they're rivets.
They're rivets.
Yeah.
Okay.
Before I start putting in standoffs, before we forget about it, I'm going to go ahead and pop in the IO shield.
Yes. Is this one padded or it looks like metal clips?
It is not padded.
Okay.
Just push it in all four corners, it clips.
Yeah, that was much more painless than my videos.
So, and then we do have a standoff post. Thank you.
Thank you.
It makes lining up the motherboard and everything like that so much easier.
Yeah.
And we're going to go ahead and add in our screws. Just going to take a quick glance at the motherboard.
Mm-hmm.
We'll basically do a standoff here, three across the top, and then three across the bottom.
Yeah. Yeah, especially when the case does not have the standoffs pre-installed, or even when it does, I would definitely recommend looking at your motherboard because sometimes those middle screws shift around a little bit, their location. So that is something to be aware of.
Let's start this one.
All right, now we can use the tool.
Yeah, now we can use the tool.
You said it wasn't magnetic enough to hold the standoff inside the tool.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and then it just helps. Just, you know, basically just thumb tighten them and then just go in. You don't want to over tighten them, but you also don't want to leave them so loose that if you have to remove your motherboard, the standoff comes with it.
Right. It's just convenient, too.
Yeah. So much easier than
trying to ruin your fingers by twisting these in by hand. Yeah. Done. Set that off to the side. Now, before I put my power supply in, I'm gonna wrap a couple of these cables.
Right.
Just to go ahead and stick the fan cables off to the side because I'm gonna do those last. But I'll just pull it up so I can see what I'm wrapping. The one thing that me and you always look for in a case is an easy way to plug in the HD audio cable without it completely ruining the aesthetic of what you're trying to go for.
Yes.
And luckily, this case right here has a little spot that I'm pretty sure is specifically for the HD audio.
Yeah.
So what we're going to do, however, once the motherboard is in, you can't fit the HD audio through this.
Right. So we need to route that first.
Right. So we're going to go ahead and pull this over here.
It's always amazing what cases seem to work out the HD audio problem.
Yeah.
Like, again, regardless of price point.
Yes.
So seeing it on a $50 case, it's always nice to see the little things.
Yeah. And then everything else that we have is basically going to go on the bottom of the motherboard. So I'm just going to kind of leave it off to the side right now.
Okay.
So we can fit our power supply and everything like that through there. So now we will go ahead and grab this. Just set it in. Fan. Pointing down,
right,
intaking through the bottom using a filter,
then exhausting out the back.
And then exhausting out the back.
Floods. Venoms asks, what parts do you usually put into a case first? It depends. It depends build to build, and you'll see that when you watch our streams. But generally speaking, once you're starting to put things in the case, it's IO shield. And then a toss-up between motherboard and power supply.
Right.
Sometimes it matters. Generally, the bigger the case, the less it matters.
Right.
You get smaller, you get constraints.
Or if you have a shroud or something like that. So.
And then after that, hard drives, and then kind of connect up all your cables. And generally, the last thing is the graphics card.
Yeah.
You get your radiator in if you have an AIO.
Right.
And then you do the graphics card last because it just sits in the middle and it has one or two plugs. Very simple.
Yeah.
So that's the order we generally take.
Yep. So I'm going to kind of push all the cables back here for right now, and then we're going to get ready to install our motherboard.
All right. I'll let you touch that since I'm not grounded at all.
Yep. Just slot it in here.
Mm-hmm. And you want to align it with the IO shield and that mounting standoff.
Right.
It should really just set into place, just like that.
Yeah, just like
perfect.
That. So, and then it is just a mounting standoff. It isn't also a mounting hole, so you will not be putting a screw
in the side. Correct. Post. Okay. Shaping up to be a nice build.
Really quick. One, two, three. Yeah.
Very quick.
So while we're already down here, before we start getting too constrained or anything like that, I'm going to go ahead and plug in the HD audio.
Mm-hmm.
So just make sure the pin is lined up. Push it. Down in there.
It's got
nice,
it.
Nice and out of the way.
Perfect.
So
nice toolless design.
Mm-hmm.
No extra screws that you have to put into it.
Perfect.
Hard drive unboxing. Ordered a hard drive lately. It's very minimal.
Yeah. Anti-static bag and a plastic holder.
Right. And we're using a Seagate 2TB. Basically, you just line the holes that are on the cage. Just pop it in. One thing you do want to do is make sure that your hard drive is facing the right direction.
Right.
Not that I've ever accidentally put them in backwards before, but
never. You know, never.
Just always check. It just slides in, sets in, so you're good to go.
Perfect.
So first I'm gonna route the 8-pin through because it's gonna go kind of the opposite direction of the rest of the cables. I'll pull it to the side.
Okay.
four pin.
We got you. We got kind of twisted there. Looks like they pre-zip tied them for you.
Thank you. There's SATA. And then, so for your PCIe, you could do it one of two ways. You can zip tie everything and just have it sitting right here. I think it looks a little bit cleaner to kind of come from the side, kind of run around the side of the card and plug it in.
Okay.
So again, that's just a preference. You can do it from either way.
Absolutely.
So this way also helps keep the access cable away from the fans though. So put it over there. Now we're gonna run our front IO, power switch, hard drive light, USB 3.0 port and USB 2.0 port through the bottom. Just give us a nice clean instead of coming around this way and then going down.
Right.
So, and then the fans will do last because we kind of need to get the rest of the cables out of the way first.
Sure.
Push this cable up here.
We got a 24 pin holding it down, it looks like. Yep. There you go.
And then push my 24 pin.
Yeah. There was a question about water cooling. I'm not sure if that was more generic about the case itself or about our specific one. Clearance at the top is not good for a radiator, but clearance at the front is good.
Yeah.
So you could absolutely mount a radiator to the front, assuming your AIO would reach.
Right. So get my SATA cable over here.
Yeah. And I'd have to double check the fan mounts on the bottom, but if you remove that cage, you might be able to.
You can fit a 120 on the bottom.
Okay. The holes on the bottom, the venting is long enough to add another fan.
Yeah.
So
you can fit a 120 on the bottom, 120 on the back, two 120s up top. Comes with 120s up front, or you can also get 140s to put up there.
Right. Yeah, supports up to a 280 millimeter radiator.
Correct.
For the specs.
So I'm going to go ahead and start plugging some stuff in. It's going to be a little bit wobbly because we're sitting on our cables right now.
Yeah.
But basically 24 pin. Clip. Get our 8 pin. Pushed in and secured. And then I'm going to save the SATA for hard drive until last. Get some. Let's see here. So before I start plugging in the easy ones, I'm going to go ahead and plug in the hard ones, which is the power and power switch, reset switch, power light, hard drive light. So looked at the manual. It's basically you have your positive LED for the hard drive or for the power switch, negative LED for the negative port.
Yeah.
For the LED, power LED, then your power switch, then you have your hard drive light, and then your reset switch.
Basically, if you have any questions about the front panel, some boards have it printed on them.
Right.
Or you can always check your motherboard manual for the location and the polarity for the cables. B2Scred is asking, how good is the stock AMD CPU fan? From our experience and what we've seen, they're pretty good. They're quiet. This one doesn't have an LED, but the higher end models have like an RGB LED ring on them.
Yeah.
So they're very nice.
I think they look very good. They go on very easily.
Very, very simple install process. I mean, we've had good experiences with them so far. We'll run benches afterwards.
Yeah.
And so you can see the temps.
There's our USB 3 port in there. And then our USB 2.0.
Yeah.
So, and then, yeah, we're almost ready for graphics card. I'm going to set it up one more time. Going to use the right angle connector because I think it actually fits just right.
On the hard drive back there?
Yeah, or on our from our motherboard.
Oh, from the motherboard. Okay. Yep.
And then I'll lay it down this way so I can plug in the hard drive power.
Okay. Perfect.
So we have our SATA data, put it into the motherboard, plug it into the hard drive. Come around this way, plug in our SATA power. And set these.
Just kind of tuck them away for now.
Yeah. Not doing full cable management, but doing it, you know.
Right.
So you can get a nice idea of what it looks like.
Right. Venom's also asked, we'll be showing the process to get the computer started after it's finished, like BIOS. We've already installed Windows and some programs on it, like some benchmarking software and temperature monitoring. So when we boot it up, it may go to BIOS, but more than likely, I think it'll go straight.
It's gonna go straight,
straight into Windows.
So, gonna put these. Do take one fans right here, and then the other guy's gonna be up this way.
We do have another video on our channel, though, showing you how to install Windows 10 if you've never done it before, how to create the media, the USB media. So if that's something you need, sure to check that out.
Flipping back over now. So now we're going to take this fan header, plug it in right here. It's bottom fan. You can plug it into any, basically, available fan header.
Right.
The way I normally try to do it is kind of relate it to which fan it is, so it's easy to know. Mm-hmm. Top fan at the top if there is one, bottom fan at the bottom if there is one.
Yeah.
So, and then you'll want to make sure, so right here we do have a pump header and a fan header, so make sure you plug it into the fan header.
Right. And again, read up on your motherboard manual documentation. A lot of these CPU opt and W pump headers can be adjusted inside the BIOS to change to like a chassis fan if that's all you have on them.
Yeah.
So
we are ready for our power or our graphics card now. So kind of look at the slot. We're going to take away number 2 and 3 and back.
And qubit the main asks, what's the purpose of the build? Is it just a budget build? It's about a $1,200 system, I think we said, $1,100. Yeah. So, I mean, it's a solid gaming machine. We're showing off some new Ryzen CPUs. But the most important thing was that Fractal said they had a new case coming and asked if we'd like to show it off and get our hands on it to do a build in it, see what we thought. So that was the big thing for us. Is we like new hardware. And
yes.
And so it gives us a chance to build in something new.
Yeah. We're using the GTX 1070 from MSI, the Quicksilver.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of go more with, you've probably kind of noticed now, a silver theme
right.
that we have going on.
Right. So. Yeah, white can be dangerously hard to match. There's like white and eggshell and off-white. And so black and silver inside of the kind of unified white case. It's going to look really nice. Right.
I've already removed the...
like protective plugs.
Yeah, protective plugs that come with it. Sometimes when you're plugging those in, if you don't take those out beforehand, they can be a real pain to actually get out once you do have it.
Yeah, they don't fit nicely through the holes at the back of the case where we remove the expansion slot covers.
Right. So. And you just pull off the protective cover on the slot, stick it to the side.
Then make sure the slot is open.
Yep.
And then just align it. Push it in. You'll hear a click.
Yeah, perfect.
And you're good to go. In. And just use the screws that you took off of the slot covers.
Mm-hmm. And we leave the covers on the SLI there.
Yeah.
Just, I think it's a slightly better aesthetic than
I think it looks
bare
good.
Connectors.
Right.
So.
Plug in our graphics card. The graphics card is a 6 and 8.
Six and eight pin. Yeah.
So we have a 6+2.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll pull one to the side for the 6-pin, push it down, and we'll zip tie that later on in our cable management, and then plug the 8-pin in.
Mm-hmm. The Quicksilver is a very cool card. It's black and silver, but it's got white LEDs, and I believe, is this part RGB, or is it just white?
This is RGB.
It's RGB.
You can do a couple different colors on this.
Okay.
So I think I have it set everything to white to kind of...
Match the rest of the build.
Yeah, match the rest of the build.
Perfect.
One thing I almost forgot about...
What's that?
So this motherboard does come with an RGB header.
Mm-hmm.
So since we're not using the RGB cooler, we can use, combined with Gabe Mod Strip, a RGB header with it.
Right.
So what you want to do, again, check the motherboard manual for this.
Mm-hmm.
You can see it's white, or I can see it. It's probably kind of hard to see on the camera, but the white is basically your 12 volt.
Right.
So you're going to look on your strip and you'll have an arrow usually saying what's 12 volt. Push that down. If you don't do it, it's not going to work. Could
if you have it backwards, you're going to do some damage to your strips.
So just be careful.
Yeah.
Always double check the motherboard manual.
Yep, and the cables too, because the RGB is not always in the same order, which is why I think, are we using an adapter there?
Yeah, we are actually using an adapter.
Right.
To take it from RGB to, I believe...
RBG?
Yeah, BRG.
Oh, BRG. Okay. And it's just this is just the cable mods LED strip, correct? Yeah.
It's a real thin cable, so just take it. And our plan is to put it right up here, kind of light up the top.
Right, just give a little bit of glow in there, almost like a cold cathode would. I saw somebody mention those earlier. So
we'll just basically plug it in again, matching it up. Should have a little arrow. Yep, there's an arrow on both sides.
Okay.
Plug it in. So the top case is metal, so therefore the mod strip is magnetic.
Right. Always nice to see that. And that is not something we mentioned earlier, I don't think. The case is metal.
Right.
I think the front has some plastic.
Yeah, the front is plastic.
But the sides are metal, the frame is metal.
Yeah. What I will say about the front, sometimes that you see when you have a white case and a plastic, metal white case, metal plastic front, is sometimes the white is off.
Mm-hmm.
I have to say, just looking at it, Vectil did a very good job matching the two whites, so not having that slight eggshell color or anything like that that can sometimes come through.
Completely agree.
So everything is back together. I'm going to go ahead and kind of put it back in, except for the side panel, put the front back on, put the back panel on.
Yeah, before you close everything up, it's always a good idea to give it a test boot and make sure everything's working.
Put it out. Banged it on. Literally everything.
We already have a keyboard and mouse, don't we?
There we go. Yeah, I've got one.
We've already got one.
So, there we go. You can kind of see the light shining from the top, lighting the top part of the case.
Yeah.
I've got everything going. So we're seeing the window screen here.
Just a minute, yeah. Yeah, let's get the keyboard and mouse hooked up there. We're still on a black screen.
Saw something.
I know some of these builds are taking a little bit longer to boot. Yeah. So, well, there we go. Your device has changed. CPU or memory or your CMOS has been cleared. So we just need to hit F1 to load the defaults. Pretty standard the first time around. If you if you boot up a PC without keyboard and mouse plugged in, it's gonna ask you.
Yeah. And here's our BIOS. So we're not gonna really mess with anything right now.
Mm-hmm.
We see our processor. We see all our RAM. We see our hard drive. So good to go.
Do we want to turn AMP on for the memory?
We can.
Let's give that a shot here. I believe that should auto overclock our memory. Yeah, there's a 1 and a 2.
I'll leave it on 1 for right now. We can always mess with it later on when we're doing the benchmarks after.
Sure.
There we go.
All right. So there's the BIOS splash screen. There we go.
Okay.
And then instantly in Windows. That was fast.
You guys want to put this side panel on?
Yeah, we can.
Yeah, we absolutely can.
True.
Oh, I took it from you.
Okay.
Oh, let me get some peeling too.
Oh, yes, yes. Yeah, so we have peels on the interior and the exterior.
Mm-hmm. Nicely done. And while the bench is running, Barry, let's get your thoughts. This is your first like official building it on stream and using all the parts. What do you think?
I think it's a great case. I think the price point for what you get is more than a bargain, because you're getting nice from the nice metal. It's textured. It's not shiny white.
Mm-hmm.
The front is matched beautifully for a white case.
Right.
You get two fans that are LED, so you get a little bit of glam, a little bit of showness, depending on if that's your thing or not. Mm-hmm. And everything went together. It's got the pooch out in the back that helps you with cable management. We've not done the final cable management, but just not even really neatening up anything. Just kind of pushing the cables kind of about where they'll go, fit real nicely.
Right.
I mean, it's good. It's very easy to build in, very simple. It comes with a standoff tool, saves my fingers.
Mm-hmm.
So I have no complaints. Comes with plenty of filters also. I thought that was a nice thing to add, because if you've ever ran your computer for a while and then you take a look on the inside, it gets very dusty. So the filters help.
Why don't we check out 3D Mark here? It looks like it's, for whatever reason, it's kind of hanging.
It's collecting.
Still?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, then I'll give my thoughts on it. I mean, I've watched you build, so I like to see the little things on a budget.
Mm-hmm.
So including extra standoffs, having a standoff tool, right, having a mounting standoff in the middle there,
yes,
all in a $50 case are fantastic for me.
Yeah.
The thought to put in routing for HD audio was great. The case is very wide open on the side, so mm-hmm. I mean, you have the option of removing your 3.5-inch drive cage so that you can put in radiators or more fans or bottom fans.
Right.
It's a lot of flexibility.
Yeah.
For not a lot of money.
Yeah, I agree. I especially like the fact that they didn't rivet the hard drive cage in down at the bottom to give you that flexibility to take it out. Even if you're not putting a radiator in front or anything like that, if you just want to take it out just to have it look clean if you're not mm-hmm. using it, it's very, very nice to see that, to still allow you to add your personality to a case.
Yeah. Yeah, really the only, if I had to come up with kind of a con for it, would be that bottom dust filter not being
the
enclosed kind of in a traditional plastic case. But at the end of the day, I mean, it clips in within seconds. It's not a big deal. And I mean, how often are you messing with your bottom dust filter?
Exactly.
So, not a big deal. There was a question about the memory still being a 2133. We'll check. I'm not sure. And in the interest of time, it's probably safer for us to just bench it and take a look at it for the completed build.
Yeah, just the out of the box, everything put together, your first run sort of thing.
Right, because tweaking memory for Ryzen can be a little
finicky.
And since we've got them right now, idle temps were 41 Celsius on the CPU and 34 on the GPU.
Okay,
so it's a little warm on the CPU.
Yeah,
but our studio is a little bit warmer than your average room.
Right,
so take that with a little bit of a grain of salt there. You know, it's only running at 20 to 30 FPS. But I'll be honest, it's got to be one of the smoothest ones that I've seen.
It's probably because it's not jumping around so much.
Yeah.
So, that's a good score.
So 14,805.
Yeah.
Obviously, this is pretty much stock.
Right.
We haven't overclocked anything. So we can compare it online real quick and see what that looks like. Yeah. So we're better than 87%. I believe it's an 87.
Yeah.
Of all other systems. It's not too bad. I mean, this isn't the top-end Ryzen. It's not the top-end NVIDIA or just graphics card in general. So to beat almost 90% of all builds.
I think that's extremely good.
For $1,200?
Yeah.
Not too bad.
Yeah.
Not too bad.
And, I mean, you know, I'm slightly biased since I just built it, but I think it looks good.
Right. Do you want to pop the temps up there so we can we can let them have a look at them? Our load on the CPU is 68 Celsius, and the load on the GPU is 65. So that's great.
Yeah.
I mean, those are fantastic temperatures in my mind, especially 65 on the GPU there.
Yeah,
so
it gives you plenty of headroom if you do want to try to overclock your GPU. So
yeah, that's great. And I mean, at this point, you can only go out from here. I mean, you can you can double check the memory, overclock it to, I think, 3,000.
Right.
You can overclock the graphics card. You can overclock the CPU.
Right.
So to beat almost 90% of systems at stock, that's pretty good. You can have a lot of fun with it, too.
Again, thanks to Fractal for sending us their new case.
Right.
And thanks to MSI for providing the B350 Tomahawk.
Yeah. So if you enjoyed our content or learned anything new, please give us a like, subscribe, and follow.